Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're on the Columbia River below Wanapum Dam for summertime sockeye and king salmon. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television.
So this is a Brad's Kokanee cup plug, and even though it's marketed for Kokanee, and hopefully you'll see today, some of our biggest Chinook every year are caught off these little tiny baits. They come in several different colors. This one here was really good yesterday. That's our Seahawk Kokanee cup plug. And then new for this year also is Hot Melon. And we caught some fish on that one too. So hopefully it'll repeat today. Welcome aboard, Buzz.
Thank you,
Great
Chris.
To finally fish with you.
I appreciate the invite, my
Absolutely.
Friend.
All right, so we're backing down into the below Wanapum. As you can see, there's a big pool here with some big rough white water. I highly suggest if you come down here for the first time, you probably should go with somebody that's experienced. Even though it looks calm, there's some undertows and some weird currents, and you can get in trouble real quick. As you'll see today, we'll get close to that white water and it's pretty gnarly. So I suggest you go with someone that's been here before you come attempt it yourself. Today, guys, we're gonna run 6 rods. 3 of them are gonna have shrimp spinners, and 3 of them are gonna have a combination of either Kokanee cup plugs, mini cup plugs, standard cup plugs, and the original skinny super bait. And we're just gonna, you know, what we're gonna do this morning is just go through all the baits and just let the fish decide and see what they want. When you think sockeye, you think creel, you think shrimp, small baits, small presentations. That's typically how we target them. What you're gonna find today is, you know, we're going in there with our Chinook gear. We got the new Brad's 360 Evolution, and behind it we're gonna have some shrimp spinners and different cut plugs and super baits. And so we're targeting Chinook, but these sockeye, it's just crazy this year how they are just, they're real aggressive and they're just hammering it. Jeremy, why don't you go 25 or less, and then that middle rod, let's peg that one at 25 this morning. Okay. But those front rods, 25 or less.
Let's do it. So we're fishing below Wanapum Dam. This is a sockeye and summer Chinook fishery, and it's happening right now. And of course, this year on the Columbia, we've got maybe the second best sockeye run ever. The fish are really coming back because of good ocean conditions. They're better, they usually average about 3 pounds, but this year they're 3 to 4 pounds because ocean conditions are really good. Feed is really good. So the sockeye are a little bigger than normal. Don't get me wrong, they're not big fish anyway, but this run of sockeye in the Columbia is unique in that it's smaller than the ones I've caught like in Alaska and other places. But they're really numerous. They're just as good eating. They're really bright up here because they move up the river fast. So anyway, we're here with a bunch of other boats trolling below Wanapum, downstream from Wanapum Dam on the Columbia River. And we're gonna get them.
So guys, these fish are, we're fishing for sockeye and Chinook. They're gonna bite several different ways. The Chinook, you can tell because when they're chewing it soft, the rod's gonna be, flexing more. I don't usually wait on it. About the time you go over to grab the rod, it's already, pumping pretty good. Usually all I ask guys is don't set the hook. And the sockeye, they're gonna do their thing. But when you're down here fishing for the Chinook and you're in sockeye water and you have a rod that's not working, there's a good chance there's a sockeye on there. And sometimes, we call them little bait robbers because if you haven't had a rod that's been bit in a while, you need to check it. And a lot of times if you're running shrimp or something, they just come up and steal the shrimp without you knowing it. But sometimes they'll get hooked and they're actually like just following the flasher and not even making the rod jump.
Yeah.
He's little.
That's okay. We'll take
him. He's little, but he's a fighter. Good job. Yeah, he is. Squirrely. Whoa. Yep.
First one of the day. Nice little sockeye. Get on the board with him.
Nice little eater fish. This is a sockeye salmon. So. Estimates are way above our actual numbers are way above what the estimates were. I think the first estimate was 130,000, then 200,000. Now they're looking at 400,000 and more. So they're pulling up right here, and yeah, we're able to get one of them here and came all the way up 400 miles to go 200 miles back down to Buzz's house.
Welcome back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're fishing just below Wanapum Dam for summertime Chinook and sockeye, and Buzz Ramsey has our first fish of the morning in the boat, a great-eating sockeye.
So the we switched to the silver blade because we got bit on that, and that's what got the sockeye this morning.
So every time you catch a fish or get bit, the flashers trip. We call that trips. So just simply plugs right in the groove in the back and you're ready to fish.
That's handy, that release deal. I like that a lot.
You get a good, you know, you can actually feel those smaller fish where, you know, some flashers, other flashers, you might not get the same fight.
Yeah, and you actually designed this flasher. Is that
right,
Chris?
I did. Yep. Yeah. Years of prototyping and perfecting it. And then finally, we got it where we wanted it exactly. And that's when Brad's decided to pull the trigger on the molds. And you know, one thing I do want to add, it's a hot tip with this flasher. It works really well. And I think that one's done wrong. It works really well, but this is one thing I want to show you guys. Yeah, it's gone. This is fishing, it works great. But here's a hot tip. You want to pull that bead chain all the way through so that your hardware is up against there. The reason being is it allows that front edge to catch the water, and that's what makes it so effective. If that bead chain's all the way through, you kind of lose that effect. It still fishes, but maybe not as good as that. So just something, if you're going to run a Brad's Evolution flasher, that's something to...
And those three holes, how does that affect it?
So that's the beauty
of
this...
We're on the middle hole here.
Yep. That's the beauty of this flasher, unlike others, is it's adjustable. And it's adjustable in the fact that it's got three holes in the front. A fast, medium, and slow. And what we mean by that is there's two ways to look at it, the troll speed or action. So you're gonna get less action, faster water, more action, slower water, and more action even yet in super slow water. And the way you adjust it, Buzz, is just simply detach the back, undo your bumper, pull your bead chain through, and then you readjust it. The cool thing that we've been seeing with this flasher is let's say we're running a big bait, Kokanee, or a SCP, the big cut plug. That's not going to act the same as a small Kokanee cut plug. And the cool thing about this is you can let the fish decide. Do they want big baits or little baits? So when we're running a big bait, this may not be thumping what you want, that 1,000 feet a second. So what you do is just simply undetach it, re-plug it right in the middle there. And now when you deploy this rod, it's going to give it more action. And it's the same thing with the Kokanee cut plug. It's going to be a little lure back here, and maybe that flasher is going to be working too hard. You can do the same thing, just reverse it. Now it's got too much action, I need to slow it down. So you adjust it, go to the top hole.
And then of course the release is the same for all of them.
Yep.
Yeah.
We get asked all the time too. You can run this fixed. Like guys out in the ocean, they're having, lots and lots of takedowns, and they didn't want to mess with the breakaway. So you can simply take that breakaway off, snap onto the back, there's a hole in the back there with the do-lock, and then just simply grab onto the front, and you can run that as a fixed flasher if you need be. The other thing with this bungee breakaway system, it's real important to know that you're not relying on the rubber to fight the fish. There's actually a 130-pound Dacron cord that's coiled up in there. So we got 18 inches of stretch. So you're not, gonna land your big fish on just a piece of rubber. If that rubber fails, there's a 130-pound Dacron cord inside there.
Yeah. A lot of people don't realize the summer Chinook used to be the most numerous in the Columbia. For example, in the 1880s, for about a 10-year period, the annual average summer Chinook run was 4 to 5 million fish. And at that time, they were cyclical then, just like now. So at that time, the commercial harvest, which was mostly at the mouth of the Columbia, was 1 to 2 million fish per year. That's how many they were catching. And they were gill netting with sailboats. And And anyway, that run over the years, it was over harvested and suffered habitat things going on, habitat degradation, you know, chipping away at the numbers. But the real clincher came in 1941 when Grand Coulee Dam went in, because that blocked the majority of their habitat. These days, there's still summer Chinook, and they spawn in some of the upper river tributary, upper Columbia tributaries, like the Wenatchee. And but these days, I mean, if we get a run of 100,000, that's a pretty good run. So, but they're still here, and we might catch one this morning.
Right, got a king on, guys.
Going right for the hot water right there. That's what we're trying to keep him out of.
Yeah, that's where it gets fun.
Take a couple steps forward, Scott. Sorry. By the way, I can get on the kicker.
Yeah, that water, buddy. I've had them go out in that, and they literally will take a couple hundred feet of line on you.
Not sure. What was on the side
rod? We've been switching them out, just seeing what the fish want. I'm not sure. It's a super bait of some sort. So. CP, Seahawk.
Seahawk.
And he is a misclip.
It's a misclip fish.
Oh.
All right. So that Seahawk this year, all up and down the river, spring all the way through start of summer here, has just been red hot. I mean, for sockeye, for kings, for everything.
We're fishing the pool below Wanapum Dam for sockeye and kings, which are both eating spinners and cut plugs.
SCP, Seahawk. Okay, so obviously this is a hatchery fish. You can see a little nub there. That doesn't mean it's a wild. The nub will even be bigger yet. There's some fish that are being released because there's a round adipose. And it looks like it's wild. But the adipose, it's about the size of your pinky. That's not the size of an adipose for an upriver Chinook of this size. And what it is, what you want to look for, is like this healed scar. There'll be like a, there'll be the adipose that looks round, but it's half the size of a real adipose, and there'll be just a nub right there that will tell you that it's a misclip. And those are good to keep. If it's been manipulated at all, it's a misclip, and you can go and harvest it. But I highly suggest you talk to your local game wardens and see how they regulate. Oregon actually printed out a whole sheet that, you know, it's a no-brainer. You look at the sheet and, yep, I can keep it, or I can't.
Pictures.
Yep, it's got pictures.
So have you talked to the game wardens here, and what have they said?
Yeah, they said if it's manipulated at all, it's free to go. Yep. A chunk taken out of it, half the size, anything. So
the size of one of those is going to be a regular intact adipose fin is going to be size of a nickel.
About your thumbnail or bigger.
Thumbnail or bigger.
Yep.
So, and that's clearly.
Yep, that's clearly. But there's been a lot of misclips this year. So, and I've been seeing some fish go that I think were misclips, but I'm not sure. But anyway, that's a beautiful fish. It's going to eat well.
Venison. Last year's Oregon deer.
They're tasty. We got our net here, and it's nice to net them, but it also could be a real pain. They thrash around in the net in the boat and then make a mess. So now that the fish are starting to wake up, and I'm confident that we're gonna get our limit or near our limit, we're just gonna start hand lining them.
Well, hooks.
For our shrimp spinners, when we're targeting these sockeye and the kings, I like going a little bit smaller. This is big enough to catch a big Chinook, but it's also small enough that the sockeye have no problem getting them.
You know, we just got some beads on there. 3.0 blade, but these are size 2-aught hooks. Spaced back pretty, about a half inch. And what I'm finding with these sockeye is you want that trailer hook right about there. And it seems like when they come up and nip at it, they'll just nip at it. And that bottom hook will end up getting them. And then during the fight, hopefully the other hook will find them too. Go, 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 go. There we go. See, that's how you guys do that.
Gotta be quick.
The legend to come show you how to net these guys. Good job, Buzz.
Yeah, not a bad sockeye.
Yeah.
Well, right here, you're on.
Yeah.
Another one. Jeremy?
Good job. Woo, getting her down now, guys.
So the limit this year is four sockeye per angler. And so, you know, you got to punch them on your punch card. We're in Washington State. So even though I've just caught two so far, landed two, Chris is telling me to go ahead and just punch four because you're going to catch them. So, okay, we'll do that. This baby in the net.
Oh, it's hot.
Oh, yeah. Whoa. He does not want to come, does he?
No.
Boy, they can shake that hook quick. I know that. They're really little fish.
Oh, good job.
I think that's a king. If it is, it's not woke up yet.
Small chinook.
Is it?
Yep. Oh, and he's wild. Yep. We have to pop the hooks on that one. As Buzz was saying earlier, it's four sockeye, but it's also six salmon, six chinook, but only two can be adults. And so we have the whole six fish limit thing going on, meaning you can keep two adults and four jacks, but you can't keep any jacks after you've obtained your two adult chinook limits. So that would have been a good little bonus fish. We don't catch a lot of them. We catch one or two maybe a day. There's a lot coming up the river, but there's just not as many that we catch.
Welcome back to the Columbia River, where Chris Turvey, Scott Paul, Buzz Ramsey, and Jeremy Herrick are working on a great day of chinook and sockeye fishing, with KCP cut plugs being the hot lure.
Yeah, we got some tuna here in oil, and then we got some Procure shrimp and prawn oil, and I think some sardine and some herring oil as well.
In our super baits and cut plugs, we're just running chicken of the sea, tuna in oil. You can do the water as well. And today we had a lot of shrimp prawn oil. The thought process was to try to go after the sockeye a little bit better with them. And we also put a bunch of herring oil in.
Yeah, hang on.
All right.
Yeah, here we got him. We got him.
Like the feel of it?
Yes. Yeah, it's got some weight to him.
That's a...
Oh. Right on.
Woo-woo-hoo!
And he's going home.
And
he's coming home.
What a stud.
Now we're getting into some fish. What do you think, Buzz? Is it the pressure change, or you think a bunch of fish just came in?
You know, sometimes they're moving in like early in the morning, and in the evening, of course, we know they move more. So getting out there early a lot of times is about, it depends what the fish are doing. But if they're moving, they may be squirting through here and not really bite. But if they stop, like now, when it's a little later in the morning, and then they start biting. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. There we go.
Now he's really acting like a chinook. Deep. These summer chinook really like to stay deep. They must be, I don't know if they're more sensitive to the light or what, but they really like it deep.
So again, this is that hot melon that we just put out. The TPKCP 45 hot melon. Hello, flash.
You factory guys are all like, you know, all the stock
the numbers.
Come
on, you used to know them. I bet you still do if we pick your brain hard enough.
Oh, yeah. A lot of them. Maybe not all of them.
Good job, Buzz. Select the fence of the rod.
one of those things, you know, fresh bait, you just put it out, you bait it up, put it in. In fact, Jeremy just asked me, hey, is that bait it? I said, just did it. And boom, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Using a Kokanee lure for salmon.
Big salmon.
Big salmon.
Feeling bigger.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
adios,
yeah.
Amigos.
It's big. It's big.
Not quite ready.
We're in a swirl. Got a fish on right next to us, too. That's cool. Buddy Danny Hofak right. Fighting one.
All right, we're hooked up a little bit.
Oh, maybe not.
Nice fish. He says no.
Not today.
He says no.
All right. Here we go. We got this. We got this. Come on, buddy. You got to be getting tired. Looked like a good fish.
Yeah.
He didn't feel all that big. He felt chinooky, but he didn't feel all that big.
Isn't that funny?
He knew he was hooked right away.
Yeah.
It's like they, it takes a little bit for them to wake up, you know.
He wasn't too sure about it.
Well, he's a keeper.
Hey. Yeah. Right, buddy.
Going a little bit of line off.
I like it.
Right there. KCP. Right
here. We got the TP KCP 45, which is a hot melon, and it's been a pretty good combo the last few days. And Forever says you can't catch king salmon on small baits. Right there. There you go.
A big feeling in the wild, but the fingers are crossed. God, it's just crazy how strong these fish are. These hatcher too. You know, but as far up river as these fish got to go, and just how much spunk, how strong.
Yeah, I mean, that's a strong fight. I mean, granted, we're right next to the rip here, and so he's got a little extra current, but still, you know, we got inside enough here, and he's still ripping line right inside here.
Thanks for making the time to watch today's episode, and I hope it was time well spent. Now, if we can help you out with your own fishing, be sure to stop into the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. And remember, without our sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.